Well, that, I have a sort of a strange answer to that question. Being an immigrant to this country from a culture that was heavily oriented toward engineering and technological skills, the brain drain eras of immigration law in the U.S. Encouraged the immigration of engineers. Even though I ended up specializing in the humanities, I've always had this secret life of technology. When growing up, I read every science fiction book available in my public library branch. There were no more. The first books I read in English were the Tom Swift books. When the internet came along, this was fairly early on, about 1992 or 3, I had this sort of aha moment when I realized that there was a way that I could bring together my humanities research in literature. I'm an English professor, and my secret life of technology, and the two have blended together very well since then. That story is a bit anomalous, but I think it is generalizable. My last book was titled The Laws of Cool. It's about this general sort of phenomenology, aesthetic lifestyle that our students, all the way through the pipeline to people working in the firms and corporations now, call cool, part of which is a kind of aesthetic of technology. It's a will or an urge to bring the practice and techniques of technology in which one invests one's working life now together with a broader sense of humanistic meaning. My case is a little bit anomalous, but I think it's expressive of a sort of a general will to bring the culture of technology and the general culture together. Now, I'm an English professor, but I started out sort of straddling the line with history. My first book was titled Words for the Sense of History. It was part of that movement at that time in the 1980s called the New Historicism, a kind of a return to history in the literature and interpretive fields there. My fields in that regard have been very eager to think about digital technologies and especially network technologies now for a number of different reasons. If we look at this from the historical angle, one of the pressing concerns right now for people thinking about new media, as they call it, is the apparent lack of historicity and of historical awareness. We live in the age of internet time, apparently, when nothing older than the last quarterly cycle in a dot-com firm seems to matter. How do we think about long durées of history and the kinds of historical awareness that past humanities traditions, whether in the history department or in the English department, for example, cared about? How do we think about the relationship between that and contemporary cultures of history now? From the English perspective, it's been just as fruitful a kind of an encounter with digital and network technologies. I like to tell my students that we missed the invention of printing, darn it. But here we're on the scene of the invention of something that may not bulk quite as large as the invention of writing or printing, but has something of the same stature and the same social, political, economic, and cultural significance, the invention of a digital and new media technologies. We'd be crazy not to get up as close as possible to it to see how it works and how it intersects with the cultural play of the imagination and of cultural life. So a lot of people in my department at the UC Santa Barbara and in the UC system, for example, and other parts of the country, who were bred up reading poems and novels are now trying to think about how those poems and novels were themselves new media in their day, the forms that were at the top of the food chain, as it were, of new media writing and printing and reading technologies, and how that might translate to our understanding of the life of imagination now in the age of spreadsheets and files and databases. Our students are more or less inclined to understand technology as part of their lifestyle, which they should. They're not yet accustomed to thinking of it as part of their work style as well, and that therefore a certain kind of discipline rigor needs to be applied to it. I'll be talking about this at this conference as a matter of fact. For many of our students, and to be honest, for many of the rest of us who are higher up the food chain in the academy as well, what the internet, for example, provides best of all is good enough knowledge, what the economists call satisficing knowledge. You need a fact, jump on the internet and you Google or Wikipedia it, you get the first two or three hits, it's good enough for the purpose of the research here. It's the same kind of sampling technique which our students are used to applying when they're searching for music, when they're searching for bits and pieces to put on a Facebook or MySpace.com page. It's part of a larger approach to knowledge and understanding in the world today. How do you understand a war? You sample a few pieces of video, assemble for you nicely on a TV screen here. How do we make the bridgeway or transition from that to a more disciplined and robust model of knowledge, where, for example, you sift information sources, you think about the configurations in which they might belong together. I'm not sure the answer to that. You know, in the year 2005 through 2006, this new, somewhat over-exaggerated boosted concept has arisen in the dot-com and the digitalhistory realms called Web 2.0. It is shorthand for a whole flock of technologies whose current dominant examples would include blogs, wikis, social networking, phosonomical tagging, and so on here. Ways of enabling collective intelligence of large-scale collaboration to produce community-wide databases of knowledge outside the management and control of, for example, traditional editorial projects, traditional research in a scholarly sense. There are clearly deficiencies in that model of knowledge. Some of the recent controversies about Wikipedia, for example, speak to that very much. But there are clearly strengths to that model as well, that the academic system of scholarship, for example, has never been able to harvest or to manage. I speak from experience, having run several scholarly digital projects which are short of staffing and short of funding at all times. I think the future of the humanities in the digital age will have to do with finding a way to bring the academy into this larger Web 2.0 sphere of communal, amateur-driven scholarship, and vice versa. Finding a way to find the models and paradigms that seem to have worked out there in the wild and bringing them into our classrooms and our development projects.